sense? Let's have a show of hands from those who've got any idea what these scrambling soldiers are up to here, besides pulling army strings at Camp Gordon Johnston down in Florida. It's a jumping off point, that's obvious. And it's obvious that they're toughening up for a little job ahead. You just have to guess the kind of job. Maybe this land-happy scowl gives you a clue of the way those soldiers are getting the hell out of there in a hurry. Don't worry, students, you won't be marked on this one. They've squashed a make-believe barge down on top of a jeep, thrown in a couple of 30s to make it seem GI. Now they're pretending to be shoving ashore, knocking the enemy back. Here's a good clue. Barbed wire beaches. Incidentally, the ball of the foot is placed delicately and courteously just below the shoulders. The guy on the receiving end likes it lots better, they say. How's the score, students? Barbed wire blossoms on many a coastline these days. Norway, Holland, Belgium, France, Italy, Greece, Japan. It won't be long in some of those places before the enemy will see a scene like this. They're the amphibious forces of the United States Army. United States Rangers, the guys who strike without warning from the sea. First wave shock infantry, the fireworks. Guys who clear the beach of enemies so big a stuff can get ashore quick. And even in dress rehearsal, they don't fool. They're trained, these kiddies. Students of as rough a little nursery school as the brass hats upstairs could throw together. This is their play field. It's a little dirty out there, but when teacher has a couple of machine gunners throwing real slugs an inch or two above your tail, mud isn't such bad company. By the time the first of these babies rolls in, the beachhead has been securely established. They're Navy craft students, manned by a Navy crew and called T-boats. They're big, really big. Damn near as much stuff jammed inside as the Hoboken Ferry. 300 soldiers or 10 tanks is just a normal load. And with the guys as before, every move's as polished as a teacher's apple. No twists or angles these stand hogs haven't doped out long in advance. Practice till they can do it with their eyes closed. Invasion is a big business, students. Tojo and Adolf know that soon, somewhere, these guys will come riding the night, streaming from the sea. The first thunder clouds of a big storm. Right behind the rest of us, the storm itself. Finishing school of the amphibious command. The guys who start what we finish.
Up in Costcock, Connecticut, Harry Powers and his wife, they live down on Suburban Avenue, took the auto out of their garage and put in a heap of machinery. Young Dick Powers and his kid brother keep the place tidied up so as their father, Harry Powers, can get right to work in the garage making machine tools on subcontracts for the big airplane plants around Costcock. The government calls this a four-man shop, Harry says. They don't count me and Mrs. Powers, but we work here too. They count Gene Salvatore, though. Gene goes to high school, but he comes to work at the garage just as soon as school lets out. And they count Joe the milkman. There ain't been a day since the plant opened that Joe ain't showed up. One job ain't enough for him. When Joe gets through delivering milk to the people in Costcob, he drives over to the garage, takes off his white coat, and gets to work. Joe and Gene used to be on the same bowling team, but ain't no time for bowling now. Sometimes the milk truck's parked out in front of the garage, 10, 11 o'clock at night while Joe's working this late. Ever since Pearl Harbor, Harry and his helpers been working 16, 17 hours a day making these machine tools. Tweezers, yokes, bucking bars, riveting anvils, pneumatic hammer jaws, reamers, hinge pins, the machine tools they make airplanes with keep coming out of the Powers garage 6 days a week 16, 17 hours a day. When Mrs. Powers ain't housekeeping or cooking for the men, she's down working with them. It's the same for the boys when they get home from school. Except on Sundays, none of them get any time off. Once Harry figured he needed a rest, he went off on a fishing trip, but he couldn't sit still long enough to catch fish. He came home the next day and went to work. But when the Powers are expecting a visitor, they get cleaned up. Particularly if the visitor is James Forrestal, who's Undersecretary of the Navy down in Washington. Mr. Forrestal came to Cost Cobb because he wanted to see Harry Powers and his wife and his sons and his helpers. He wanted to give them the Army-Navy E for excellence. It wasn't much of a day for weather, chilly with a good breeze coming off the sound.
I think there is no occasion but which, in which I have participated that I have had more pleasure and more pride in my country than being able to give you this symbol. I congratulate you.
Now the Powers don't take much time off, as I've said, but when you get a big flag from the government, you want to sort of break it out. And the flag looks mighty pretty to the family, flying over their garage down on Suburban Avenue. The same flag that's flying over other war plants, a thousand times bigger than the Powers place. But they don't hang around for more than the feast. They get back to work.
Take a good look at the Potomac, boys. Or take your choice and look at Lieutenant Juanita Redmond, the redhead. Or her pal, Captain Ruth E. Parsons, of the Army Nurse Corps. Who are these young ladies? Take a good look. Have a good listen.
Juanita, do you think much about Baton and Corregidor these days?
Oh, yes. Sometimes it seems as though I left Corregidor last week instead of a year ago.
I bet you're glad to get out of that place.
No, really, it's heartbreaking to leave those girls and boys behind.
Where were you on December 7th?
I was in Manila, except December 8th, Philippine time. I was on light duty when I heard the Japanese had bombed Pearl Harbor. But even then, I thought it'd be some time before they started in on us. But the same day Pearl Harbor was bombed, Jap planes came over Manila. They took everyone by surprise. Stricken, many people lost their heads. After the first raid, the Japs came back day after day. The damage was horrible. The day before Christmas, we were ordered to Bataan to set up field hospitals. And along the roadside, I saw the results of the Jap bombs. Natives trying to save their belongings were strafed on open roads. There was no singing of carols that Christmas Eve. After Bataan, I was transferred to Corregidor across the bay. Finally, 6 days before Corregidor fell, I was evacuated to Australia. This Japanese film has come into our hands, and vividly it brings back the days I spent on Corregidor. I know how desperately our men fought. By the time I left, munitions, food, and supplies were practically gone. As General MacArthur said, never did an army do so much with so little. We all lived in tunnels like this under the constant bombardment of Jap planes and guns. This Jap movie shows the enemy climbing up the embankment for the last attack. They hit Corregidor with every man and gun they had in the Philippines. And they were a merciless enemy. I had just arrived in Australia when I heard about Surrende on May 7th, 5 months after Pearl Harbor. I know how our boys hated this moment. I knew a lot of them well. Many of them I had nursed in our hospital. They fought until they had nothing left to fight with. It must have been heartbreaking for General Wainwright, our commanding officer, whom we all loved, when he had to meet General Walmer, commander of the Jap forces.